shout. Ready? Shout out. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and let all that's within me. Shout out, Jesus. Shout out. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and let all that's within me. Shout out. Come on. Shout.
God, we are here, Lord, to give you glory, to give you praise. During this Christmas season and always, Lord, we know that you are with us. We are loving you, God, and we are so excited to celebrate your birth.
Your baby boy will one day walk on water.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters?
Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new?
This child that you've delivered will soon deliver.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man?
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand?
Did you know that your baby boy has walked angels' trial? When you kissed your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Mary, did you know?
Ooh. Mary, did you know?
Mary. We'll see.
The blind will see.
The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, praise is all the land.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nation?
Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the great I am. Mary, did you know?
The stars are brightly dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining till he appeared and the soul
Jesus, thank you, Lord, for this amazing day, God. We are so excited to just continue to celebrate God and all his goodness and his glory. We'll do the good news a little out of order today, and then we'll do the offering. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the fullness of time. As the year winds down, 2020, it will be remembered by some as the year of COVID-19, by others, the past 12 months will be memorialized by victories or tragedies. Some will remember the day God answered their prayers. Still, others will celebrate their long-awaited breakthrough. All these things were no surprise to God, and his timing played a part of how, why, and when they happen. Last week, we looked at these four things concerning the fullness of time. The fullness of man's sin will release the fullness of God's wrath. The fullness of God's wrath will reveal the fullness of God's love. The fullness of God's love should lead to the fullness of a response. The fullness of a response will stop the fullness of God's wrath. It is the will of God that all should believe and be saved. Jesus was born to bring you and me out from under the fullness of God's judgment, which will be released in the fullness of time. Christmas marks a new time in the world's history. When we celebrate Christmas, let us not forget to celebrate Jesus, Church.
Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all thy worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. And when I think that God his Son must bury, send him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my sin, and sings my soul, God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, God, to thee. How come with shouts of acclamation and lead me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. How great.
These days we say, God is good. We just read, how great thou art. I think that means God is good. God is good. And as we continue to search the scriptures and we continue to figure this thing out as we go and we dig into the mysteries of God and his truths and his promises, and we're all seeking clarity. But I know two people who have perfect clarity. One is Louisa, one is Dorothy. Both of those family members are with the Lord. I'm wondering today if Dorothy's visited Louisa yet. They're probably talking right now over a nice cup of coffee. Lord, we just pray for Sandy and her family, Lord. Give them strength, Lord. And you say that you can turn all things together for good, Lord. You know exactly everybody's days on this earth, Lord. And that was Dorothy's 98 years of life, Lord. We thank you for that life, Lord. And I know Sandy says she's going to take her mom with her, but she's going to always be here with us in our hearts. Can everybody just say, God bless you, Sandy. God bless you, Sandy. Kids, your teacher, I'm sure, has something going on for you. Follow your teacher next door. How is everybody this morning? Is anybody in the Christmas spirit? It can be sometimes hard to grab onto the Christmas spirit. Sometimes it can be a little bit of a wrestle for us. But the good news is Jesus is still King. Jesus came, and the good news is Jesus is coming back. Marlo read the good news, and we talked last week about the fullness of time. And for the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about some things that are a little scary in the Book of Revelation. But the Bible says that we should be vigilant, and Jesus says that we should be aware of the things going on around us. How many know that 2020 has been an up and down battle? The world and this country and this church and everybody, we're still fighting the good fight. We just pray for all your homes and just continue to fight the good fight of faith. Because how many know that the Bible says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. So it boils down to we do fight a fight, a good fight, as opposed to the bad fight, the good fight of faith. And we do wrestle against the things that are against God. Title of this message is The Fullness of the Christmas Gift. God doesn't do anything halfway. When he begins something, he finishes it, and he has begun a good work in you, Christian. How amazing it is that the fullness of our great God's wrath reveals the fullness of his love as manifested by his sending his Son to die that we might live. That's the ultimate gift. That's the greatest gift ever given. It is the will of God that all men believe and be saved from the consequences of their sins. We've been talking about that for the last couple of weeks. God fully wants this. God fully wants all men to be saved. God fully wants all men to believe. God fully wants this, and he is willing to spare no expense to purchase you, and he has purchased you from the slave market of sin, the Bible says. We celebrate Christmas as a memorial of the greatest gift ever given, which Jesus gave fully. Jesus doesn't do anything halfway. He didn't do anything halfway. He gave fully, and as we're going to see that in Jesus there is a fullness of grace. That in Jesus there is the fullness of freedom. In Jesus there is the fullness of security. In Jesus there is the fullness of salvation. In Jesus there is a fullness of joy. That's a 5-point sermon. I hope you're not hungry. Father, we just ask that you bless our time together, Lord. We want to hear from you. God, does anybody want to hear from God this morning? You know, Father, we just ask that you speak through this message today. Give us a new revelation of the beauty and the majesty of Christmas, Lord, and the gift that your Son came down to personally deliver to us. In Jesus' name, we pray. I want to look at some things here. There is a fullness of grace. I'm going to be bouncing around. I wrote the scriptures in there for you. There's a place where you can write a couple of notes if you want, if you need a pen. Does everybody have a study guide? Do you have a study guide? Yes. Okay, everybody has a study guide. So we're going to be in Romans. The first point I want to look at, we're talking about the fullness of the Christmas gift, which is the greatest gift ever given. And the first thing I want to look at, in Jesus there is the fullness of grace. We see that in Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3. And so if you look at Romans, that whole first part of Romans, you'll see that the writer, the great apostle Paul, he writes and he's speaking of the fallenness of man and how man needs a savior because man is fallen and he's in a deep trouble, that the wrath of God is impending. And last week we talked about the fullness of God's wrath, and we've seen throughout the history and God's interaction as revealed through the Bible, God's interaction with man, we'll see elements of his wrath, but never the fullness of his wrath. And we saw in Revelation last week, chapter 14, that the fullness of God's wrath is going to fall when the fullness of man's sin reaches its place. And if we look around, I don't know about you, but there's a whole bunch of sinning going on. I mean, beyond the pale, as a young man, I've noticed it, but as we look around, there's a lot of stuff going on all around us. And so we look at the fullness of God's wrath, but here I want to see the fullness of God's grace as revealed through Jesus. And we see it in Romans chapter 3, verse 25. It says that God gave his, set Jesus as a propitiation. God set Jesus as a propitiation. What's propitiation? Thank you. A propitiation is a payment or an appeasement for something that's due. If there's a debt, that appeasement or paying of that debt has to be paid. And there was a sin debt. The Bible teaches that there's a sin debt that unsaved humans are under, and that the only way to pay for that sin debt is by blood. And so, but as humans, it has to be human blood. But the problem is, my blood couldn't pay my sin debt because my blood is tainted. Your blood can't pay your sin debt because your blood is tainted by sin, like my blood. So it had to be a sinless, pure, unblemished blood, and that's Jesus. So Jesus, the Father set him up, set him forth as a propitiation. So what does that gain us? Because Jesus shed his blood and died for us, what did that gain us? That gained us grace. Everybody say grace. So we're under the blood of Jesus. So Jesus came and delivered the gift of grace by the shedding of his blood. In Jesus, there is the fullness of God's grace. The fullness of God's grace. The Bible makes it clear that God is perfectly just, and justice demands that there be payment for sin. And there's only one thing that can cover sin, and that's blood, and not just any blood. Has to be the blood, the pure blood, and it has to be human blood, and there's only one pure human blood, and that's Jesus. Does that make sense to you? Only the blood of Jesus can cover up sin. So when the Father looks at us, he sees us and through the blood of Jesus, and he sees us as clean, as righteous. And that's only by grace. The Bible says that we can't work for that position. We can't come into that position. We have to be conveyed. Colossians says we have to be conveyed into that position. We have to be picked up, sent on the conveyor system, put down into that new position. And now we're under the blood of Jesus when we were not under the blood of Jesus. So God now sees us as righteous and clean, clothed in white garments. Amen? So in Jesus, there is the fullness of grace. So when we celebrate and memorialize Christmas, we're celebrating that Jesus came that we might have the grace of the Father and come out from under the fullness of his wrath. How about this? In Jesus, there is the fullness of freedom. Go to the book of John. John chapter 19. John chapter 19, verse 30. This is one of my all-time favorite scriptures. It rung in my head and it rung in my spirit when I first heard it. Whoever was preaching, I'd never heard of this because I wasn't raised in church. I didn't know anything about the Bible. When I was a young man, I would say, I'm going to read the Bible because I'm going to read it just like a book because I want to know what's in there. I never did. But over the years as I come under the Lord, piece by piece by piece by piece, he's been revealing these things. But one of the first revelations that God ever gave me was this. John chapter 19, verse 28, Jesus is out on the cross, he's in his last time, his last few minutes of life. And it says here in verse 28 of the book of John, chapter 19. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he said, I thirst. Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled it, a sponge of sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And bowed his head and gave up his spirit. What's that word? Tetelestai. That word, tetelestai. It means it is finished. So there is the fullness of freedom. When Jesus here, he says, it is finished. He said, I've done what you've sent me to do, Father. What's finished? The requirements of the law of the Old Testament have been paid for and have been met by and superseded by the grace of God. What's finished? The prophecies concerning the coming of the Messiah were finished at Christmas. When he came, he finished it on the cross, but first he had to come. He came at Christmas. The law for salvation is finished. Replacing the law by grace for salvation has been finished. Jesus did that, and he said, Tetelestai, it is finished. The finished work of the cross of Christ has begun the age of grace. At the cross, Jesus set us free from the slave market of sin. To get released from a slave market of sin, Jesus had to pay a ransom. There was a ransom on your head. There was a payment due. So God set him as a propitiation. And when Jesus died on the cross, he paid that ransom for you. He paid the ransom that was on our heads. Jesus died to set the captives free. Jesus set you free for what? I love that scripture. I have been set free for what purpose? For freedom. To be free. God set us free so that we might live in freedom. And there's a scripture in Galatians. He said, be careful that you don't start messing around over here. You're a freed man. You're a freed woman. And you start lingering here and walking over there. All of a sudden, you're getting back in bondage. And you go back into bondage. There's always a danger of going back into bondage. Do you know that? Association brings about assimilation. We as Christians, we are not immune to re-assimilate with those whom we came out of from, as are the people we're assimilating with. And when we re-assimilate, we can go back into bondage. I know people like that. Maybe you know people like that. Maybe there's people in your family like that who were set free and they went and they re-assimilated and now they're back into bondage. Jesus came to set us free for the purpose of freedom. For us as Christians, to walk in bondage is an insult and a disgrace to the cross of Christ. We are free. Jesus set us free, and the Bible says that he who is set, Jesus sets free, is free indeed. In Jesus, there is the fullness of grace. In Jesus, there is the fullness of freedom. When Jesus gives a gift, he gives it all the way. When God gives a gift, he doesn't shortchange you. He doesn't go to the discount rack over there on special today. He goes down and pays full price. Amen? Jesus paid full price, and he said, it is finished. Tetelestai, I've done what you've sent me to do, Father, and he did it to the full, to the full, to the full. In Jesus, there is the fullness of freedom. How about in Jesus, there is the fullness of security. We're still in the book of John. Go back to verse 10. Go back to verse 10. Chapter 10, verse 27. And Jesus is the good shepherd. How many know Jesus is the good shepherd? I love that illustration. You know, have you noticed we're a small church? Have you noticed that? Do you know that a small church is anything under 300 members? I guess that makes us a micro church. So we're a small church. We're under 300. I think last time I counted, we were under 300. So we are a small church. And the picture of a shepherd, what is the picture of a shepherd? See, a shepherd, what does a shepherd have? A shepherd has a flock. A shepherd doesn't have a herd. We are a flock, we're not a herd. And see, the distinction between a herd and a shepherd has rancher and hired hands to watch out, because it's a herd. You can need a lot of help for a herd. But a shepherd and his flock, a shepherd can know and be involved and understand what's going on in all of the members of the flock. In Jesus, there is fullness of security. Look at there, John chapter 10, verse 22. So he's the good shepherd. I'm going to start in verse 22. Now, it was the Feast of Dedication in Jerusalem, and it was winter, and Jesus walked in the temple of Solomon's porch. Then the Jews surrounded him and said to him, like they always did, they're always trying to trip him up, they're always trying to trap him, they're always trying to get him to misspeak. How long do you keep us in doubt? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly. He answered them, I told you, and you do not believe. The work that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. I go around, I raise people from the dead, I cure the blind, I do all these things, and yet you refuse to see the work of God. They were grieving the Holy Spirit. The grieving of the Holy Spirit is the unpardonable sin, and that means to plainly see what God did and deny it. Verse 26, but you do not believe because you are not of my sheep. As I said to you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life. What does he give to his sheep? He gives us eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. What's he talking about there? He said, if you're a Christian, if you've come into the fold, the sheepfold of Jesus, nobody can take you away. Nobody can steal you. How many know that there's forces and there's things and there's wiles of the devil and all kinds of, it could be a just life in general has a tendency to try to steal us out of our walk and our relationship with Jesus. See, but there's only one way that Jesus will let you go, and if you walk away, but you cannot be taken away. You cannot lose your salvation. He's saying no one can steal you out. So we're talking about the eternal security. If you're saved, do we have any Christians in here? If you're saved, your salvation is secure. Yet, we just saw that even if you're saved, you can get go and reassimilate with some people or a lifestyle you should not be engaged in, and all of a sudden you're back into bondage. So we have to understand that we have to stay. Hold on tight to your, hold on tight to the Lord. Amen. In Jesus, there is the fullness of grace. In Jesus, there is fullness of freedom. In Jesus, there is the fullness of security. How about this? In Jesus, there is the fullness of salvation. Philippians 1:6. Philippians 1:6. The Apostle Paul writes to the believers in Philippi, and he tells them, I am certain of this one thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it. Will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. What does that mean? Full salvation will be realized when we leave this physical reality here on earth and into our spiritual ultimate destination, our ultimate spiritual destination. Where? In heaven. This is the fullness of salvation. See, we're saved and we understand we're Christians and we're still here. We're still here. But see, the fullness of our salvation won't be realized until we, like Jesus, who is the first fruits of our own glorification. That means to change and transfigure into a glorified state. That's when the fullness will be realized. Though we're saved here, our ultimate salvation is there. Amen? And when God says, I've done something, he'll talk about your future and talk about it in the present tense, because if God says it, it's done. If God says it, it's finished. If he says you're going to be glorified, he'll call you, you are my perfected one, you are my righteous one. See, that doesn't come into the fullness of its manifestation until we are glorified. Does that make sense to you? Well, if I'm not going to reach the fullness now, how should I live here in this life? See, we're supposed to live a life, the Bible says, as one whom is so loved, right? And so we're supposed to try to take on and be a little more like Jesus today and a little bit less like us today. And so that's a process of sanctification, which I don't want to get into here right now. The fullness of salvation, full salvation will be realized when we live this physical reality and enter into a spiritual reality. How about one more? In Jesus, there is the fullness of joy. This is the Christmas season, and joy can be fleeting. There's so many people now, believers and non-believers alike, who are lacking that joy because of the situation all around us that we find ourselves in. The lockdown, some people are falling into depression, some people are falling into despair, some people are giving up, and others are fighting the good fight of faith. And see, that's a decision. How many know that joy is a decision? Joy is not predicated on how we feel or how what the situation that we are in is. Joy is a decision. And so it's also a decision that we must make not to allow that joy to be taken. And there's moments, maybe it's just me, but there's moments when I feel that joy fleeting, I have to actively search it out and go back and grab it and bring it back. Because if I allow that joy to come out of my heart, all of a sudden, as me as a head of household, allow it to come out of my home. And that's a problem. And that can be a struggle. We as parents, we as grandparents, we as leaders in the church, we have to grab onto that joy because we're accountable to the people who we are in charge of, or our family members, those who are whose lives we're speaking into. And if we come, if we don't express that joy, how are they supposed to grab that joy? Do we have any believers? Do we have any mature believers in Christ? We as Christians, we as people who have been serving the Lord and searching after the Lord for some of us decades. The Bible says that those trials are there for a reason. And we have to be able to go through the trials in the midst of a trial and grab on and regain that joy. If you let that joy go too long, the farther it gets away from you, the harder it is to chase it down and bring it back. In Jesus, there is the fullness of joy. Go to Luke chapter 2. Just speaking to anybody out there. Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2, verse 8. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings." Everybody say good tidings. That's good news. Good tidings of great joy. Everybody say great joy. Good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David. Do you see that? I love that. It says, for there is born to you. To us, he's talking about the gift that's been brought to us. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior who is the Christ of the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes lying in a manger. What's a manger? A manger is a feeding trough. A feeding trough. The King of the universe, though, John says he has made everything in heaven, everything on earth, and yet he couldn't find a place to lay the infants at him as an infant. And this is God. You know what God could have done? God could have said, what do you mean there's no room at the inn? Holiday Inn right there across the street. He could do whatever he wanted to. Yet he allowed him to be put in a feeding trough. This is the creator of the universe, the savior of the world. And as his life goes on, Jesus says, foxes have holes, birds have nests, and everybody has a home, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. This is the creator of the universe. This is Jesus, the creator of the universe, and he brought the greatest gift ever given. And he comes in humility. How many know that the gift that we give, the best gift that we can give is to someone who can't give us anything in return. We get caught up in that dueling gift thing, right? Well, he gave me a $15 gift. I better get him a $20 gift. And we can get caught up in that, but that's not what this is about. Jesus says, I'm going to give you something that you can't return. No matter what you do, no matter how you live, no matter how hard you try, you cannot give me anything in return that would equal this, and I don't want anything in return. I'm giving it to you because I love you. The greatest gift ever given. In Jesus, there is the fullness of grace. In Jesus, there is the fullness of freedom. In Jesus, there is the fullness of security. In Jesus, there is the fullness of salvation. In Jesus, there is the fullness of joy. Yet we find ourselves in this time of trial and trouble and isolation and uncertainty. There's people going through some very serious things. There's people losing their businesses. They're losing their life savings. They're losing their life investment. They're losing their dreams. They're losing everything. Losing all of it. And yet, season is here. Christmas season is here. How do we grab onto that joy? How do we maintain that joy? The Bible says that there's nothing new under the sun. The Bible says that there's no trial that has befallen you that has not come to somebody else. We are not the only ones. My household is not the only one suffering. There's all around us at this time. So how do we stay? How do we hold on to that joy? The Bible says in Psalms, it says, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Jesus, the book of Revelation says that Jesus is the bright and morning star. Jesus is the bright and morning star. When things are at their darkest is when the sun is just over the horizon. Do you know that? Have you ever experienced that? Have you ever stayed up at night or woke up way before, a couple hours before the sun comes up? It's darker. It's very, very dark. And when that sun comes up, daylight comes. The Bible says that Jesus came down into darkness. He's the light of the world. He came down into darkness when weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Joy can be fleeting, hard to hold on to, difficult to regain if we let it go. Christmas is a season of joy, and Jesus is the reason for the season. For many, this Christmas season brings with it times of trouble and uncertainty. This season of joy seems to be fleeting, a little harder to hold on to and more difficult to recapture. This Christmas season is different, but God isn't. God's will for you has not changed. His love for you is just as strong as it was before COVID. And his love for you is just as determined as it's ever been. Joy, like always, is still available. Joy, like when Jesus first did it, was paid for by our great King Jesus. It still has the same value. It still has the same accessibility. It still has the same blessing attached to it. This Christmas, let us hold on tight to joy in our homes and in our hearts. Let's hold on tight to joy by holding on tight to Jesus. Does anybody receive that, worship team? The fullness of the Christmas gift, when unwrapped, is precious. And it's made up of many, many miracles, some of which are grace, freedom, security, salvation, and joy. We've talked about recently that there's some going on 8,000 promises in the Bible. All those promises are in the Christmas gift. All that, maybe you're one that got pulled out of a lifestyle that God just delivered you from, or a habit or something like that, some kind of bondage, all that is within that Christmas gift. Father, I just pray that you reestablish the joy in the hearts of those who know you but seem to be struggling right now with understanding, or not even understanding, but remembering what you did, Jesus, at the cross, Lord. Father, how you sent your only begotten Son because you love the world so much that you sent your only begotten Son, Father.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nation?
Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the great I am. Did you know, Mary, did you know?
It says in Joel that God speaking says that he will pour out his spirit on all men, and old men will dream dreams and young men will prophesy. And that happened when the Holy Spirit came, as documented in the book of Acts chapter 2. The Holy Spirit came and there were moves of the Spirit. And how many know that God still speaks? God still speaks, and he'll speak directly in your heart. Sometimes it'll be a situational thing. He'll speak through a situation. Sometimes he'll give you dreams. Sometimes he'll give you visions. God has given me visions over the years. And God, if you've never experienced a vision from God, just ask him, God, I want to see. God is merciful, and he wants to reveal himself to you. Don't discount the things that God shows you. I wanted Moise to come up here. He shared a vision recently that God gave him. So I want him to come up here. I think it'll bless the church. So come up here and share that with us, Moise.
It's a hard thing to do because God's good. God's good. And as Pastor Jim was saying, you know, God talks to us. He'll talk to us in a dream, in a thought, in a way to people that we don't understand. But we need to listen. We don't always listen. So I was there, and apparently God was there. And, you know, I was thinking about everything, and about Christmas and how everybody runs around. It's a rat race. People go crazy, frustrated. And then COVID came, and no one could do the things that we always do, which is go shopping, congregate with friends, you know, have parties, do the things we did. It's not about the gifts. It's not about the little fat man. It's about what I've done for you. I'm here this year, as always, to heal you, to heal your nation, to take care of you, to show you the love that I have only for you. That's what God is telling us. It's not about everything else, but it's here. God is here to deliver us, to heal our nation, to heal us, to take away our aches, our pains, our discomforts, our angers, our frustration, but to make him first in everything that we do. Because God, this is Christmas. Christmas is the day Jesus Christ was born, to deliver us, God, to raise us, and to make us as he did, in his image. So if we are in his image, we should be full of love. We should be full of understanding for each other. We should not be sitting here wanting to receive from someone. We should be wanting to give. So I just wanted to share that with you, and I'm sorry that I got emotional, but God just touches my heart, and he just tells me things the way they are. And I just wanted to share that moment that God gave me. And I want to thank you all for your kindness and your prayers. Thank you so much. Pastor Gene, thank you.
Thank you, Lord. We praise your name. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day walk on water?
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters?
Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new?
This child that you deliver will soon deliver you.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man?
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand?
Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kissed your little baby, you kissed the face of God.
Mary, did you know?
The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, praises all the land.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nations?
Did you know that your baby boy is on the neighbor's land?
This sleeping child you're holding
is the grave.
Jesus, we wish you a blessed and peaceful week. We are gathering on Thursday for Christmas Eve candlelight service at 6:30. If you can make it, we would love to have you. Go and be blessed and have a very Merry Christmas week. Amen.
Thank you. We got it finally.